I'd like to start by introducing Assistant Professor Jace Jones. He's the Associate Professor of Mass Spectrometry Center, Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences at the University of Maryland School of Pharmacy. Jace earned his Ph.D. in analytical chemistry under the supervision of Frank Teresic at the University of Washington, where his thesis was on developing gas phase ion chemistry strategies to gain structural insight into peptides and glycolipids. Jace then had a brief postdoctoral position in the laboratory of David Goodlett at the University of Washington School of Pharmacy, where he further developed tandem mass spectroscopy platforms for structural elucidation of bacterial glycolipids. He then left academics research and took a position as technical director at an analytical lab. Then he came back to academic research and then was appointed the research assistant professor in the laboratory of Maureen A. Kane at the University of Maryland School of Pharmacy, where he is currently an assistant professor and associate director of the Mass Spectrometry Center at the University of Maryland School of Pharmacy, where his research group focuses on developing mass spectrometry platforms to probe the structure and functional dynamics of lipids, glycolipids, and glycans. Jace Jones.
Thank you. Good morning. Would like to thank Waters, especially Progenesis, and John and Mark for giving me the opportunity to share some of the research that we've been working on. Okay. So before we get started and let the coffee kind of settle and kind of pick everybody up, I'd like to show a few images and kind of ask the question, what do you see? I'm going to be talking about traumatic brain injury, and so I thought I would liven it up with some brain exercises. So I'll put these images up, and then I'll kind of circle back around, and once again, I'm asking you to see, you know, some of these images have been circulating around on the internet, but the idea is, what do you first see as you look at the image, and then are there other types of data or other types of details that become more clear as you look at the image? And the last one to provide a little bit of color. And so what I would ask is when I show these images, what do you see? On that first image, it looks, there's an older woman looking forward, and if you look a little bit more closely, there's what appears to be a younger woman facing backwards, right? It might not be obvious at first. The second image in that top right corner, the two phases seem to be fairly obvious, but in the middle there's a vase, which has multiple meanings. The bottom right image, there's an image of a woman, followed by right next to her a man playing a saxophone. And then the fourth image up there, I think it's pretty obvious to see the two faces that are looking at each other's eyes, but I'll let you give you guys a little bit more time to see if you can focus in on some of the other details in that image. And the point here is that at first thought, we tend to see, as it relates back to science, we tend to see the data from our own perspective or what we're interested in seeing. And I'll extend that to this image here and ask, what do you see with this image? My perspective, looking, studying lipids and looking at lipid structure, what I immediately focus in on are those glycerol phospholipids, that bilayer. I'm interested in what is the head group. I'm interested in the acyl chain length and the degree of saturation. I'm also interested in terms of the cholesterol that's interspersed within this membrane, or even some of the sphingolipids, the glycosphingolipids. Now, if you were to have a protein perspective, I'm sure the first aspects of the plasma membrane would be the proteins, either the protein channels, these transmembrane proteins. And what I would like to emphasize is, looking at these images or looking at data, we tend to focus on what our interests are. But it's when we kind of take a step backwards that we see that it's an interconnected biological network. And that being said, now I want to focus, I've just kind of laid the groundwork for saying that all these molecules are interconnected. What I would like to do is to spend the rest of the presentation talking about our interest in lipids, but with the backdrop that Lipids are part of an interconnected biological network, and so we try to consider lipid structure, lipid abundance in the context of a biological function. So I have two images or two figures here from recent reviews just to try to highlight the role of lipid function, or excuse me, lipid structure and how that lipid structure affects function. And also, if you didn't have a chance to see the lipidomics tutorial last night, I would strongly encourage you to see that tutorial. It was a fantastic review by Gavin Reed and Stephen Blanksby in terms of the current, the history of lipidomics and kind of where we stand now. So I think it was a very nice review, and there's a lot of great information there. And this figure here just highlights the role of lipid structure and how lipid structure by changing the phospho in terms of the plasma membrane, how the head group can affect plasma membrane fluidity and dynamics, but also the acyl chain length and the degree of saturation highlights some of the structural impacts. And I would further say that not only are we interested in structure, but we're also interested in abundance as well. And so my group is interested in trying to define lipid structure, anchoring that structure to abundance, and then trying to translate that into biological activity or function. And so we use mass spectrometry-based platforms as our primary analytical tool. This is just a schematic of a couple of the workflows that we're focusing on. I'm going to spend a majority of the time on our what we call our untargeted or discovery workflow. And then at the end, I'll tie in a little bit of the quantitative work that we're doing as well. Okay, so with that, what I'd like to do is transition into the biological application. One of the projects that we're working on is with traumatic brain injury. Traumatic brain injury is a major cause of disability worldwide, especially as it relates to young adults. Traumatic brain injury results from physical impact to the brain. And in such examples would be sports-related injuries, car accidents, falls or assaults, or even explosions or blasts. From that primary mechanical injury, it actually initiates a cascade of cellular and biochemical changes, which further propagate injury. And these injuries are propagated by what's commonly accepted or commonly referred to as, you know, just oxidative stress or inflammatory processes. And it's the result of these processes which contribute to that chronic or long-term injury. And so TBI affects long-term cognition, sensory motor, and personality. TBI is associated with chronic neurological and neuropsychiatric sequelae. For example, a lot of the dementia-related diseases. And it's imperative to understand the pathophysiological mechanism of TBI and neurodegeneration. What we want to do is try to understand what are those initial events which lead to this chronic injury. So if we look at the time scale at which TBI happens, so you have that primary injury that tends to be sudden, it tends to be instantaneous, and that's what leads to these secondary effects, okay? And it's during these secondary effects can happen over hours, days, weeks, or potentially even months, and it's during this time period where there's a potential opportunity for therapeutic intervention. And so what we're interested in trying to understand is what are those initiating biochemical events which lead to the long-term injury, and trying to understand where that therapeutic window is, where we could potentially offset some of these long-term, some of the long-term effects of the TBI. One of those biological processes that we're interested in studying is autophagy. Autophagy is a normal cellular process by which cellular debris is engulfed in an autophagosome. The autophagosome lyses with the lysosome. And the lysosomes have proteases, which can degrade that cellular debris, so it can be recycled in other metabolic processes or discarded. Autophagy can protect cells during stress, but it can also be dysfunction of autophagy can also cause some deleterious effects as well. And autophagy flux is inhibited after TBI. What is believed to have happened, and unfortunately, the bottom of the slide there are where I put the references, and there's a series of references that have talked about how disruption of the autophagy process is affected by after TBI. The thought process or the idea is that the lysosomes are the membranes becomes disrupted, the lysosomes become leaky, which causes this autophagy flux to be disrupted. You get this buildup of the autophagosomes because the lysosomes are just not functioning properly, which can lead to neuronal cell death and potentiation of injury. In addition, TBI is associated with an increased activity of phospholipase A2 activity. What we believe is happening is that increase of the phospholipase A2 activity is causing a disruption of the lysosomes. It's damaging the lysosomal membrane, which causes them to become leaky, which causes them to not function properly. And so what we were interested in asking is, can we take these lysosomes from this model, and can we identify lipids that potentially can be indicative or inform on this particular process? And so that's what we set out to do. The mouse model, which I'm not going to go into too much detail, that's in the laboratory of Marta Lipinski, a collaborator at the University of Maryland School of Medicine. It's a controlled cortical impact mouse model. What I'd like to spend is the next few minutes kind of going over our workflow and then talk about how we integrate Progenesis into this process. So once again, the mouse model and the samples. So we're looking at brain lysosomes, and we have a TBI, we have a sham cohort, we even have a cohort where we're using a C+2 inhibitor, which I'll talk about in a minute. The lipid extraction is a fairly straightforward, fairly common technique. We're doing liquid extraction and looking at total lipid extracts. The analytical portion involves LC coupled to tandem mass spectrometry. The LC format is, once again, it's fairly standard LC parameters. We do both a C18 separation and a helix separation. The data I'm going to show today is all from a C18 separation. And for time's sakes, I'm not going to go into too much detail of these, but feel free to ask if there's any questions about some of the analytical details or how we're setting up our parameters. The mass spectrometer that we're using is, at least within this work, is a Waters Synapt G2S. We do both positive and negative runs. We collect with the lock mass to give us accurate mass. We enable the traveling wave ion mobility, and we're using data-independent mass spectrometry. And I'll show you what some of that data looks like. And then kind of on the back end, on the processing angle, all the data is filtered through Progenesis for our data analysis. There's a few other back end software tools that we use in terms of visualization and identification as well. Okay, so what is the data? What does the data look like? What I'm showing here in the bottom right is just a base peak chromatogram of a C18 separation of a total lipid extract from these brain lysosomes. From this we can get chromatographic retention time. We can get accurate mass. We can also, what I'm showing above here, since we're doing data independent acquisition, where we're taking alternating scans of a low energy scan and then an elevated energy scan, that gives us both our precursor and our product ion information. The top chromatogram is just an extracted ion chromatogram of a master charge 184, which is characteristic of phosphocholine. We can interrogate the data further by pulling out a tandem mass spectrum. This is with the benefit of ion mobility. So we get, in this example, we get a fairly clear tandem mass spectrum. We can go through, we can annotate the peaks, we can look at accurate mass, we can get some structure information to get an idea of what the acyl chain lengths are, and there's some indication as in terms of what the positions actually are. We can go in a little bit further and we can identify diagnostic product ions. So that's what some of the data looks like. At the end result of that is that we get multidimensional data. We're able to look at the chromatographic retention time. We get precursor accurate mass. This has eye mobility, so we can get drift time. The drift time can be corresponded back to collisional cross section. We get tandem mass spectrum, and this is done in positive and negative ion modes. Okay, so after we collect the data, and then what we want to do is we need to process. We need to be able to handle the data. We need to make sense of what the data is telling us, and so we use Progenesis QI to help us with that. And so I'll walk through a few of the slides that show some of that workflow. This is just a screen capture of the retention time alignment. For the most part, we don't really deviate too much in terms of what are the default settings are in terms of retention time alignment. We do C18 separations. We get very, very good retention time alignment. Those tend to be very reproducible, and we're above 90%, mid-90s or so in terms of that scoring. If by chance that scoring is low, we can go back in and actually modify some of that alignment, or what it is, it's a QC example in terms of a QC a parameter that allows us to tell us the quality of the chromatography. Another aspect of the Progenesis is in the peak picking. This was performed where we're doing the sensitivity was just a default setting, an automatic setting. We tend to toggle back and forth between the automatic setting or what we'll also choose is the option for the percentage of the base peak, depending upon how many compound ions we're looking at or trying to deal with. Once again, this is pretty standard workflow that we're not deviating too much from what the default settings are. And there's some other settings here, as you can see, that can be adjusted. The peak picking process of the software, here I've highlighted where this is just a ceramide peak that I've picked out. What's interesting here is that it allows you to look at multiple adducts. Ceramides typically ionize with the M plus H minus water, but you can also see that the sodium peak is very abundant as well. There's also a smaller abundant peak in terms of the M plus H. The adduct formation can be viewed as a pro or a con, depending upon how you're looking at it. Multiple adducts gives you kind of increased confidence that you have your lipid species of choice, but it also splits the signal as well across multiple adducts, which can reduce your sensitivity. You also have some issues in terms of having multiple adduct formation. They provide different types of fragmentation. I don't have time today, but we are interested in kind of consolidating adduct formation, in particular to drive fragmentation. It's something that our lab is working on. If anybody's interested in that, I'd be more than happy to talk to you about that. Next, in terms of identifying the compounds, this is just using lipid blast feature. I've shown a pretty nice example where the scoring is actually looks pretty good. The identification came up with an ether PE, and you can see the matching tandem mass spectrum that we get. And so lipid blast, we tend to do the lipid blast identification as an initial screening, but there is the identification process is very challenging for those of you that do lipidomics, and we tend to spend a lot of time on this particular aspect of the lipidomics process, and not everything is done in Progenesis. We do a lot of things by offline in terms of trying to corroborate structure ID with retention time, with positive and negative correlation, also with eye mobility and tandem mass spectrometry. Another view is with the Progenesis, you can review the compounds. There's a variety of parameters on this screen as well. And there's also some compound statistics as well here showing that the PCA plot here showing that the sham versus our TBI are well separated. Okay, so with that, I'm gonna breeze through some of this other stuff. It looks like I'm running close on my time here. In addition to doing Progenesis, we also do a lot of, we also use metabol analysts as well. We like metabol analysts in terms of its visualization software. It's fairly efficient, it's fairly easy process. And all the data that we import into metabolanalysis has all been kind of processed through Progenesis. We can do a PLSDA plot, we can do a heat map, a volcano plot. At the end of this process, we, like I said, we get this multidimensional data. At the end of that, we are able to confidently identify 146 lipids that were differentially expressed between our sham and our TBI. Okay, so I'd like to focus in on a few lipid on a particular lipid class that we're excited about, that we're able to kind of pull out as being significantly different between our sham and our TBI, and that's are these this is a vinyl ether phosphatidylethylamine. So as opposed to the diacyl arrangement, the ether glycerophospholipids can either be in a vinyl ether arrangement or actually an alkali ether arrangement. Where the phosphatidylethylamines are commonly found as a vinyl ether, the PCs are commonly found as an alkali ether. We found a series of these vinyl ether PEs that were significantly downregulated in the TBI cohort. Here's just an example of a list of these TBI, of these vinyl ether PE structures that we were able to confirm structurally, just some of the other details. So what does this mean in the context of our TBI model? And so as I explained earlier, TBI causes the injury. We see this increase in the phospholipase 2 activity, which causes the lysosomes to become dysfunction, and it disrupts the autophagy flux. So what we wanted to do was, what happens now if we have a C+2 inhibitor? If we actually inhibit the C+2 activity, what's happening with the lipids that are present in these lysosomes? And what we're able to find is that those vinyl ether PEs that were actually down after the injury, those are actually recovered to a certain extent in the mouse that were treated with the C+2 inhibitor, indicating that this is a potential therapeutic opportunity by repairing of that autophagy flux. And so we're currently investigating this process and trying to find out more information about how we could potentially use this particular model system to offset some of the brain injury effects. Okay, and the last part of the presentation, what we have done now is taken that our discovery workflow, we're transferring that onto a quantitative workflow, and here I'll just show you some examples of where we're at, and this process, we're currently in the process of trying to validate this method, where now we have our list of our vinyl ether PEs. We want to then transfer that to a quantitative assay using still similar chromatography. This is just a C18 separation. Which chromatography looks pretty good. We're actually in the process of switching this over to a helix separation. This is advantageous, especially in terms of internal standards, especially when we want to do quantitation. But this is an example of just looking at MRMs of these vinyl ether PEs on a C18 separation. What's interesting is that our discovery workflow corresponded really well with our quantitative workflow, indicating that discovery workflow was robust, and it gives us confidence that we can transfer back and forth between discovery and quantitation. So in conclusion, the UPLC HD MSTD platform generated multidimensional data that allowed for confident structure identification. Progenesis QI is a bioinformatics processing superhighway. It provides us an efficient and robust processing of our multidimensional data. It allows for expedited discovery of potential lipid markers. We were able to identify several vinyl ether PEs with polyunsaturated fatty acids that were differentially expressed in the lysosomal membranes of the mouse TBA model. And our ongoing efforts are being undertaken to transfer this over to a quantitative assay. Okay, with that, I'll circle back around to this picture here. Maybe you've had some time for the coffee to take effect. And what I would say is that, and so you can kind of see the details within the image, Progenesis QI really facilitates a process for us for seeing what is not always visible at first. It really allows us to kind of focus in on particular groups that may not have been obvious at first thought. Okay, with that, I'll wrap up. So I'd like to thank the members of my lab. Yuli is working on the quantitative assay. An is another graduate student, and for those of you interested in some of the other lipid projects that we're working on, we have two posters. An has a poster on ceramide analysis via MALDI-TOF, and then I have a poster on sphingolipid metabolism in a drug-induced liver injury model using a very similar workflow as I described today. I would also like to acknowledge collaborators and continued work with Maureen Kane. She's intimately involved in this process, especially as we're trying to develop validated quantitative assays. And then also Marta Lipinski for her lab in terms of as a collaborator for having the TBI model. And then I'd like to thank funding sources and also Waters. And with that, I can take any questions.
Great talk. Mass, what's the key to differentiate the lipids from the lipidome from other tissues in the brain?
So the process, so looking at the lysosomes, they were actually fractionated. So we had just whole lysosomes that we were looking at. Is that the? Yeah. So we're looking at just isolated lysosomes that have been fractionated. Cellular components. We are interested in looking at other at whole tissue, and then but also other organelles as well. And that's currently under work.
Yeah, I'm interested to understand how you're using the CCS values that you're getting from your synapse. So are you building your repository of CCS values? Are you using them as part of your identification to have better scoring? Because that's also useful.
No, it's definitely something I kind of glossed over. But so, in large part, so we are using it as a parameter for searching, a parameter. But what we use the drift time correlation. The drift time really allows us to reduce the complexity at the point of detection. So in terms of our tandem mass spectra, and then what we're going forward is that we're going to be there's a number of other research groups that are trying to populate CCS values in terms of database searching, and so we're in the process of figuring out how to integrate those CCS values, and it's a process, but that's the core.